normalized volume in quasi-fixed interval at 3 megahertz.
Yeah, so it's really a pleasure to be speaking here. Yes, sorry, 50, you mean? 40? No, okay. Yeah, so it's a real pleasure to be speaking here, you know, for the 40th birthday of Francis Bonnaroux. You know, when I prepared this talk, I had the occasion to reflect on what I've been doing in the last, you know, maybe 20 years. No, not that much, but almost. And I realized that, you know, whenever I went, you know, starting with, you know, hyper-ideal, hyperbolic polyhedra, and quadrifixed manifolds and so on, you know, I met ideas from Francis. And they were very often very interesting and very inspirational ideas. So it's really nice to be here. Okay, now, I'm going to be to talk about quasi-fixed manifolds. Actually, this is not true. I'm going to be talking about things that usually work for, you know, convex or compact hyperbolic manifold with incompressible boundary. But for simplicity, I will focus on quasi-fixed manifolds. So what is a quasi-fixed manifold? You know, this was explained in the talk by Minsky yesterday. So I'm not going to repeat this. So a quasi-fixed manifold for me is a convex or compact manifold homomorphic to S plus R. So I'm thinking of this as a manifold of this type. So it's the product of a surface and R, and it opens up at infinity in this way. And one way to define it is that it's a complete hyperbolic structure on S plus R, which contains a compact, non-empty, convex subset. And this, you know, implies this opening up at infinity property that is here. Okay, so we know a number of things about such a manifold. So the first thing is that because we're looking at a manifold with a complete hyperbolic structure, it is a quotient of hyperbolic free space by a group action. And here, the action is given by rho. Rho is a morphism from the fundamental group of the surface, S, which is also the fundamental group of the manifold M, into PSL to C. Now, we can look at this in this following way. So we can define the limit set of rho, and the limit set of rho is obtained in the following manner. So we take any point X in hyperbolic free space, and then we're going to look at the orbit of X under rho of gamma. And we're going to take the closure of this orbit in the closure of hyperbolic free space, say in the projective model, for instance, and we'll get something at infinity that is the limit set of rho. And it's going to be a Jordan curve if we start from a quasi-fixed manifold. Actually, it's a way to define quasi-fixed manifold. It's a Jordan curve in the boundary at infinity of H3, and as you all know, the boundary at infinity of H3 is identified canonically with CP1 with its usual complex structure. Now, I'd like to remark that, as you know, also the rho of the fundamental group of S, rho acts by, you know, hyperbolic isometries on H3. So it acts on CP1 by elements of PSL2C. So complex projective structures, also called Möbius transformations. And the point is that the action of rho on the complement of lambda gamma, of lambda rho, sorry, the action is probably discontinuous. So we have a probability discontinuous action on both this upper part of the curve and the lower part of the curve. And the boundary at infinity of M, there is a mistake in my notes. So this is the boundary at infinity of M, right? So the boundary at infinity of M can be identified in this way with S plus difference with S minus. And S plus is going to be a quotient of this by the action of rho, and S minus is going to be a quotient of this lower part by the action of rho. Okay? So, this has interesting consequences. So, I'm claiming that from this definition it's clear that S plus and S minus both have a very interesting geometric structure, which is what is called a CP1 structure. So CP1 structure is a GX structure on the surface. And in this case, GX structures may have local models, which are modeled, the surface is locally modeled on X, with transition charts, which are given by elements of G. So in this situation, I mean, this is more or less a direct consequence of this description, because the boundary at infinity of M is locally described by pieces of CP1, with changes of charts given by the action which is bimodal transformations. So we have this very rich structure on the boundary at infinity. I'm going to call CP as the space of complex projective structures on S. And just to give a perspective, the real dimension of CP of S is 12 G minus 12 if G is the genus of S. So it has twice the dimension of the fractional space of S. So we're going to call sigma plus minus the CP1 structures at infinity on the two connected components of the boundary at infinity. And because CP1 has an underlying complex structure, and Möbius transformations are also complex transformations, given any CP1 structure, there is an underlying complex structure. And we're going to call C plus and C minus the complex or equivalently conformal structures on S given by sigma plus and minus, sigma minus. So we sort of lose some information when we go from sigma plus minus to C plus minus. And the amount of information that we lose is more or less half the information, because we go from something of dimension 12 G minus 12 to something of dimension 6 G minus 6. Yeah? Now, I'm also going to repeat something that was already in Nick's talk, but a key thing here is the double permutation theorem of Peirce, which tells you that you have those complex structures C minus and C plus, and they would be they uniquely characterize the quasi-Euclidean manifold. So any C plus, C minus can be uniquely obtained in this manner, and basically this defines the homeomorphism from the space of quasi-Euclidean structures on M to the product of two copies of the fractional space of the surface. Okay. Now I'd like to give a few information on the convex core of this manifold. So we have this manifold M, and we said that M contains some non-empty convex compact subset. Now it's clear that the intersection of two convex subsets is a convex subset, and a consequence of this is that there is some smallest convex subset in M. Smallest being in the sense that it's included in all the others. And we can think, we can look at this object here and try to understand what it looks like. So, this is an idea of Thurston, I guess. And the point is that by definition, this is a convex subset of M, which has no extreme point. If it had any extreme point, you could cut it off by some plane and get something smaller. So you must have something that is extreme, or is that convex with no extreme point. And a consequence of this is that it has a very, very special structure, which is it's a ruled convex subsurface. And in this setting here, what Thurston proved is that it's actually what is called a pleated surface. So it's a convex surface, and you could think of it as looking locally like a polyhedron with no vertex. So you can have pleating along some lines, but things could be more complicated. So the pleating could be along pleating curves, or there is some finite amount of pleating, but it can also be pleated along a measured lamination, which means basically that you have pleating that is distributed along very, very long lines, infinite lines actually, and the amount of pleating on each line is not well defined. But I'm not going to get into this more. Basically, I'm just going to say this. We have this pleating along a measured lamination, and a measured lamination, is something defined by Thurston. It's defined as you take the space of measured of weighted multicurves on the surface, and you take the completion of this space of weighted multicurve by some natural topology, which is defined by intersection of weighted multicurves with closed curves. So you have this nice definition, this boundary of this convex core has this fitting on measured lamination. And another thing is that because it is a convex ruled surface, it is developable, meaning that the induced metric is a hyperbolic metric of constant curvature plus minus one, right? So now if we put all this together, we have those nice curvature structures associated to the boundary of the convex core of the manifold. We have two hyperbolic metrics, M plus and M minus, on the upper and lower boundary. And you have two measured laminations, L plus and L minus. Yeah?
The induced length.
Induced length. Yes. I'm sure you're correct. I'm not aware, but yeah, sure. Okay. So now we can state some interesting questions to which Francis contributed in some very unsatisfactory way. So first, then ask next questions about this. So if you have any two hyperbolic metrics on S, is it true that they can be uniquely realized on the boundary of the convex core for some quasi-Hodgkin metric on M? And so for this problem, we know that existence holds. So if you choose any two hyperbolic metrics on S, there will be some quasi-Hodgkin manifold for which the induced metric on the boundary of the convex core is given by M plus and M minus. And this, I think, I don't know exactly who this is attributed to, it's more or less a Folklore theorem, but it's a consequence of results of Epstein and Mardell, and also Fabouri, in different ways. And then also, Thurston made another conjecture, which can be seen as a dual to the first one, which is if you take any L minus and L plus on the in the space of measure laminations on S, can they be uniquely realized as the measure of Hodgkin lamination on the boundary of the convex core of M? And of course, there are some very simple conditions that must be satisfied. So one is that L minus and L plus must fill the surface, meaning that basically the intersection weight of any closed curve with one or the other has to be bigger than some very small epsilon. And another condition is that closed curve must have weight less than epsilon, less than pi in the quasi-Hodgkin setup. And the theorem here, proved by Bounaron and Houtal more than 10 years ago, is that this is actually true if you take simple laminations, measured laminations, meaning measured laminations along simple closed curves. And in general, existence holds, but we still don't know whether uniqueness holds. And I should say that, here, like in other things I'm going to say, this is also true, and it was proved actually by Bounaron and Houtal. Geometrically finite manifold is incompressible boundary, and it was extended to the compressible boundary case by Newton.
So, could you say again, closed curve has the, you mean its intersection one of the two, or the sum of the intersections?
The sum of the intersections, But I mean, this means that the intersection with one of the two is at least epsilon over two. Okay. So this is going to be a sort of motivation for what I'm going to be talking about now. And the idea is that what we're going to be talking about is another version of this in some sense. I still want to say something more about this, and I want to say something about the volume of the convex core of M, because this is again going to be a big motivation. I'm going to define VC, the volume of the convex core of M, this is M, and there is a very nice Schlieffe formula for the variation of the volume of a hyperbolic polyhedron. So if you take any hyperbolic polyhedron, and you start deforming it at first order, there is a nice formula due to Schlieffe, proved probably 150 years ago, Schlieffe, that tells you that if you look at the variation of the volume of this polyhedron, it's minus 1/2 the sum of the length times the variation of the angles. Right. Now, what Francis did is extend this to give a variation formula, which is much more subtle and very interesting, for the volume of the convex core of the quasi-Hodgkin manifold under a first-order deformation. And the formula is more or less the same as this one, but you have to understand what we're talking about. And actually the formula, it's really hard to understand what it means, and I'm not going to explain it, because you have to understand that the angle theta is now replaced by the measured bending lamination, and the variation of theta is replaced by the variation of the length of the measured bending lamination. And so what is the variation of a measured bending lamination? It does not be at all for even for me, even now, I guess. But Francis actually gave a meaning to this, and he proved that this has a meaning as something that he invented, which is called the procycle. And those things actually have a length with respect to some hyperbolic metric, M. So you can look, you can define the length of the variation, the length with respect to the induced metric M, of the variation of the measured bending lamination And this is going to be giving the variation of the volume of the polar scope. Yeah. Now, this is not really what I'm interested in.
What is there a sign difference?
Excuse me?
There's a sign difference.
Between the two?
Yes.
Oh, you'll see. I'll tell you in a minute. So the one I'm interested in is the dual formula, right? So the dual formula is the one that's going to come up later. So I'm going to define the dual volume as the volume of the convex core minus something, which is basically one half the total mean curvature of the boundary. And the mean curvature in this setting is the length of the measured pending lamination with respect to the induced metric. And basically, it's not hard. Okay, you can prove that the variation of this quantity, this is going to be given by two terms. You know, basically, let me write this in the polyhedral setting first. So in polyhedral setting, you can define this part as V plus. Oh, you mean, why is there a sign difference between this and the formula above?
Yes.
I think it depends whether you take the inside or the exterior angles or the interior angles. I could be wrong in here. I didn't define what theta is. But otherwise, I could be wrong. So this star is V plus one half the sum of Li Ti, and then you have the corresponding Bohr formula. And basically, you know, it's clear that the variation of this is the sum of the Li d theta I plus theta I d Li. So you have the V star, so let's say V star dot, be coherent. It's the sum of the theta I, the Li over the edges of the polyhedron. And now I will do this. Basically, the idea that this is the length of dot here, the length of L dot plus the differential of the length of L with respect to the variation of M. And as a consequence, you find this dual, you know, Bonaud Steffi formula, which is the variation of the dual volume. Is actually something which is much simpler to understand. So basically, you take the length of the measured lamination L as a function on Taschner space, and this is a smooth enough function. You take its differential with respect to the metric, and you take this differential on the variation of the metric. And this is the dual Steffi-Bonaud formula. And this is really something I want to keep in mind, so I'm even going to write it here on the blackboard, so I'm going to this occur again in a different form. So this is the formula that we have. Yeah. Okay. So now we are going to, you know, leave the convex core for a minute and go to the renormalized volume and to the whole manifold instead of, you know, staying with this compact subset. And I'd like to explain what is the renormalized volume of a polyhedral manifold. So, you know, first, before I forget, I should say there are two origins in this. So this can be seen as a special case of the renormalized volume of Poincaré-Einstein manifolds, which is something considered by physicists a while ago. So Hennington, Skandarys, Witten, and Graham is a mathematician who, you know, turned this into some rigorous mathematics. And it's also something that comes from, in the 3D case, it comes from the UV function, which is something defined by people doing, you know, more, you know, complex analytic things. But you know, in a way, the intersection of those two ways of, you know, doing mathematics is the renormalized volume of convex polyhedral manifolds. And I'm going to give you the definition, just, you know, to fix the ideas. And the definition is following the way we looked at this with Kirill Krasnov, I think in 2008. And the definition is quite simple. So the definition is quite simple, but you have to follow, I mean, some, you know, basic simple ideas. So first, you define a volume associated to any convex subset of L. You take N, a convex subset, and define this volume W of N as volume of N minus some correcting term, which is one fourth of the total mean curvature of the boundary. And then, you know, basically we're still looking at this, you know, this manifold M, and we're going to do the following.
So
here
you're assuming your correct set
are smooth boundaries? Yeah, that's it. At some point I'm going to start cheating, so, you know, yeah, we can make this assumption. So we have this, the following situation. So we have this convex set N,
in M, compact product set, and I'm going to call SR the surface, which is the space of the set of points and distance R from N. And basically those surfaces, if N is convex, those surfaces defoliate the complement of N. And also there is a way to identify all of them by following the flow of the normal directions. Yeah? And because of this identification, you can look at the induced metric on those surfaces on R, and then you can take the limit. Well, I forgot something completely. So we have to use a normalization factor. So one star is the limit when R goes to infinity. You have to take an exponential minus 2R, 1R. And then I'm losing something, so it should be 1, 2, I guess. 2, and of course, there is this normalization factor is missing in my blackboard. So you take the limit of those induced metric, normalize in a proper way. And what you find is a metric which happens, and it's not very difficult to prove, it happens to be compatible with the conformal metric at infinity on this manifold that we defined earlier. Yeah? And now the point is this. The point is if you start with N, you get those two metrics in the conformal class at infinity. And the converse almost works, and here I'm cheating a bit. So basically, if you take two metrics in the conformal class at infinity on both sides, you are going to get some foliation by equidistant surfaces close to infinity, which is basically what we need in this picture. And you can imagine that you get some N in this way, which is not completely true, but it's not very important. So basically, it's equivalent to take N or to take one star plus minus. And I'm going to now forget about N and only focus on one star plus minus. Those two metrics in the conformal class. Yeah? And now we have this function, W, which depends on those two metrics in the conformal class at infinity. And what can be proved is that if you normalize one star plus minus to have constant area, then you have a maximum of W if and only if those two metrics have constant curvature. In other terms, this function W as a function on the conformal class at infinity is a way to uniformize the Riemann surfaces at infinity. Find the hyperbolic metrics on the Riemann surfaces at infinity. And now the definition of the renormalized volume is that you're going to define Vr of M as W of one star when you take this maximum. So when you take one star to be the hyperbolic metrics in the conformal classes at infinity. And the point is that this is the same as a UV functional that was defined in different settings by people like Zodgraf and Tarpeyo. It's not so clear why it is the same, but it happens to be the same. And so the sort of basic property that tells you that this is something that could be interesting is that if you freeze one of the two coordinates, now you have by the vast double uniformization theorem, M is uniquely determined by C minus and C plus. So we have a function Vr from Ts cross Ts into R, right? We have this Vr from Ts cross Ts. Oops. Maybe Ts bar into R. And we can now freeze one of the coordinates, the C minus, and vary C plus. And we get a function on Teichmann space to R. And this is a Taylor potential for the vector of symmetry on Teichmann space, right? And I'm not going to talk any more about this, but this shows that this quantity has some interesting analytic properties in terms of the second variation properties of white light. Okay? Now, I need to say more about the data definition. So far we have this data definition. On the boundary of the convex core, we have M and L, but on the boundary at infinity, so far we only have C plus minus, which is basically a point intersection space. But we need more data. And the way to get this additional data, we have two ways to get it. And the first way is in terms of Riemannian geometry, and the second way is in terms of complex analysis. And they're actually equivalent. So if you look at things in terms of hyperbolic geometry, of Riemannian geometry, you can say, I'm looking at this metric, induced metric 1R on the surface SR, and I want to understand how it behaves close to infinity. So I'm going to have some asymptotic expansion, and the first term is going to be given by one star, but there will be other terms. And if you look at how things behave, It's very easy, actually. We have a term which is dr squared. You know, basically, this is because the surfaces are equidistant surfaces. And then you have one exponential term, which is one star. You have one constant term, which is, you know, something we're going to define as two star. And there is some other term which we can forget in this story. And that's all. And we're going to be interested only in the second term, two star. And this has nice properties. And we like to think of this as the second phenomenon form at infinity. And the reason is that this two star, you know, satisfies the Kodaltsky equation, like the second phenomenon form of some usual surface in, you know, Euclidean free space or hyperbolic free space. And it satisfies also a modified form of the Gauss equation, which is satisfied by surfaces in Euclidean space. And if the consequence of this is that if one star is a hyperbolic metric, then you can look at a two star zero, so the traceless part of two star with respect to one star. And this is going to be a Kodaltsky tensor, and it's going to be traceless. And you know, a general fact of life is that whenever you have a traceless Kodaltsky tensor, symmetric tensor on the surface, it is a real part of a holomorphic quadratic differential. So in this setting, this is going to be minus the normalization reasons, is going to be minus the real part of some holomorphic quadratic differential Q. And now there is a completely different way to understand this Q. And this is a complex analytic way. And you know, to understand it, you can look at the uniformization map that, you know, for the upper component of the complement of the limit set here. So we go back to this picture. And you know, this is upper disk, you know, it can be uniformized into this, you know, Riemann uniformization theorem. So, oops, Riemann uniformization. And I have this R plus. And I also have some map R minus, which is a Riemann uniformization of the lower boundary, the lower part of the complement of the limit set. And now you can look at what is called the Schwarzschild derivative of those uniformization maps. So I'm going to define this for you here. Keep this. So you know, whenever you have a map, I'm going to consider a map set from C to C, which is a holomorphic. I mean, I'm just going to take omega containing C to holomorphic. So the, you know, just the Schwarzschild derivative is defined in a different way. So f of f is equal to, I guess, f second over f prime prime minus 1/2 of f second over f prime square. And then you want to put a dz squared so that you get some holomorphic quadratic differential. And you have some really nice properties. And the nice properties are the following. So first it detects modulus transformations. So this is zero if and only if f is a modulus transformation. And the other property that it has is that for the nice composition property, so if you take the Schwarzschild derivative of f composed with f, f with g, so this is the simplest thing you can hope for. So it's the Schwarzschild derivative of g, and then you're going to add, well, g star of the Schwarzschild derivative of f. And you know, this has nice, very nice consequences. So two things have nice consequences. So the consequence is that, well, the Schwarzschild derivative is well defined for, well, you know, holomorphic maps between surfaces with complex structures. For complex maps between surfaces with CP1 surfaces. Right. Basically, those two properties are exactly what you need so that basically you can define it as a CP1 structure using charts in such a way that if you change charts, you're not going to change the Schwarzschild derivative as a CP1 structure. So in particular, this is what we use in this setting. So we have a map from the disk, to this piece of CD1, and we take the Schwarzschild derivative, and we define Q plus minus as the Schwarzschild derivative of the uniformization mass. And then this is the same as taking, if you take the real part of this, you find the second transform at infinity of those manifolds. Yeah? Now, a sort of basic variation formula for the renormalized volume, and now we are coming close to the dual Bonnow-Clapeyron formula, but we're going to get even closer, is that if you take a deformation of this quasi-flux and manifold, the renormalized volume is going to change in a very nice way. It's going to change as the change is going to be given by the real part of the natural pairing between Q, which is a holomorphic quadratic differential, and the variation of C, which is a Balcromian differential. Right, so you have, you know, a holomorphic quadratic differential on this pair with a variation of a Riemann of structure of the Riemann surface, which is a Balcromian differential. You can do this pairing, you get some complex number, take the real part, and up to sign you find the variation of the renormalized volume. And if you want to do things in more Riemannian terms, it's the same situation, basically, up to some factor 1/4. You take the integral over the boundary of M of the traceless part of the second Riemann form, scalar product with the variation of 1*, which is the metric at infinity. And this actually makes sense because 2*0, you know, it's a traceless quadratic tensor, so you can actually pair it with any variation of the Riemannian metric, and what you'll find is something that only depends on the variation of the conformal structure. So this completely makes sense. Yeah. Okay, so this can be translated in a nice way. And I'd like to say this in the setting of an analogy, which for me is quite interesting. And the analogy is between what happens on the convex core of the manifold and what happens on the whole manifold, if you look at the proper definitions. So the analogy is the following. So the volume of the convex core is going to correspond to the renormalized volume of the whole manifold. The induced metric on the boundary of the convex core is going to correspond to this conformal metric at infinity. This is quite natural. And this measured Banach lamination, L plus minus on the boundary of the convex core, is going to correspond to a measured foliation at infinity. And the way this is defined, this measured foliation, L plus minus, is just the horizontal measured foliation of the holomorphic quadratic differential Q plus minus. Right? So this is, very natural to define. If you have a holomorphic quadratic differential on a Riemann surface, you can define this horizontal foliation, and you get a measured foliation. And so the guiding principle for me is that the same phenomenon, there are two things. First, the same phenomena really tend to occur for both sides. And the second principle is that corresponding quantities are closed in a proper sense. And I can only prove a few things. Quite a few things I cannot prove at the moment, but I think this is something that, general idea that works, seems to work. So for instance, I like to state the formula in the previous slide, the variation formula for the renormalized volume was stated in terms of those complex analytic or maybe more Riemannian objects here, but there is another way to state this. So you have this measured foliation on the boundary at infinity, f, and that, there is something you can define the notion of length on a Riemann surface for a curve or for measured foliation. This is called the trivial length of the foliation. And now you can do exactly what we did before. So we are going to look at the difference. This is a function on Teichmann space. And we're going to look at the differential of this trivial length function applied to the variation of the Riemann surface structure. And this is going to give us a number in a variation of the structure on this quasi-flux manifold. And this is equal to the force of the variation of the Riemann volume. Right? So this is exactly the same as the dual Bonnaroo Clapeyron form that I forgot not to erase before that one. Right, so this is exactly the same point. I think it's exactly the same, even the coefficient is the same. I could be wrong in the coefficient. If I'm not wrong, it's exactly the same coefficient. Yeah. Now let me give a few other instances. So the point one thing that has been known for a long time is that if you look at the boundary of the induced metric on the boundary of the quantum core, and if you look at the metric at infinity, those two things will be more or less the same.
So what does it mean to be more or less the same? Well, it means that you can look at the distance in terms of what is quasi-conformal. That's the most natural thing to look at. And there was a conjecture by Sullivan for a long time that stated that those two things would be uniformly quasi-conformal for a quasi-conformal factor equal to 2. And quite a number of years ago, Epstein and Marden proved, I mean, maybe Sullivan proved, but I don't know who proved it. Maybe Thurston proved it, I don't know. But people knew that those two things were uniformly quasi-conformal for some constant which is bigger than 2. And in fact, the conjecture turns out to be false. It was proved by Markovitch, Marden, and Epstein, Epstein, Markovitch, and Marden. So the constant is that it's not 2, but it's something a bit bigger than 2. But anyway, those two things, you know, the induced metric on the boundary of the convex core and the conformal structure at infinity, they tend to be, they happen to be uniformly quasi-conformal. And now you can say what happens for the measured foliation at infinity and the measured banding lamination on the boundary of the convex core. Are those two things also those? And this happens to be true too. And this is basically, I mean, there are different ways to state this, but this is something that has been proved in a certain way by David Dumas. And now, the third object that we have is the volume. And we know that volume and the volume of the quantum four. And those two things also happen to be close. So this is something proved 2 years ago. So they're really close in a nice sense. I'm not going to state things in a complicated way. But basically, there is a constant depending only on the genus of the surface, which bounds the difference between the two. There is a uniform difference, a uniform bound on the difference between the one-on-one volume and the volume of the convex core. So in a way, I think, you know, when we look at this, is that the normalized volume is going to have the same force properties as the volume of the convex core, but it has also some nice analytic properties in the sense that it, you know, scalar potential for the factor of the metric. So, and oops, what did I do? Yeah, sorry. Yeah, and I should say that, so this was done in the quasi-compact setting, and it was extended in the complex for compact setting by Goodman and Canary, I think this year, is that correct? Maybe last year. And this is really interesting in the setting when M has compressible boundary, because then you know things are quite subtle and more interesting than in the quasi-compact setting. Okay? So, now, what, you know, we can use this. We can use this to get some bounds on the renormalized volume, and from the bounds on the renormalized volume, bounds on the volume of the convex core. So I'd like to recall the theorem by Brock, 2003. So Brock proved that the volume of the convex core is quasi-equivalent to the Weyl-Petersen distance between the two conformal structures at infinity, C minus and C plus. At that point, you know, the what we can do is we can say we can recover the upper bound and get a very explicit upper bound. In the following sense, you know, I'm saying that the renormalized volume is bounded from above by the Weyl-Petersen distance between C minus and C plus with some very explicit constant. So why is this true? Well, you know, it's a direct consequence of what we said before, because we know that the derivative of the renormalized volume is given by the pairing between Q and the variation of the conformal structure at infinity. But we also know something else, namely the Mehari estimate. You know, what is Q? We said that Q was the Schwarzschild derivative of this uniformization map. And this uniformization map is a univalent map from the disk into CP1. And a sort of general fact proved by Mehari is that in this setting, it's always true that Q is bounded from above in F infinity norm by some explicit coefficient, which happens to be 3/2. So from this you get a bound on the 2*0. And if you put this in the variation formula above, you just find directly this upper bound on the volume, the renormalized volume in terms of the data at infinity. Just because, you know, if you take the pairing of the variation of the conformal structure at infinity by something which is bounded by some constant, which is 3/2. And when you take care of the coefficients, what you get is, I think, is 3
square root of pi and j minus 1, right? And the corollary of this is that the volume of the convex core is also bounded by the same quantity times by the same distance, plus some constant which came from the previous level.
So can I ask you about the direction of the inequalities on,
on
this slide? So it seems that if the first and second are correct, then you would get the lower bound on the volume of the core. Right?
No, I'd like to get this lower bound in this way, but I don't think we can do it.
Okay, so are you very sure about it?
I think the point is that you have this this pairing, you know, basically you're saying that if you let's say you see the fixed C minus and you vary C plus from C minus to its value. So you go through some path of length L in the Bayesian metric. And basically what you're saying is that the pairing is basically what you say is this. You know, you have this quantity, 2 star 0, 1 star dot. This is less than C 3 half. Maybe the 3 half is wrong. Maybe there's a coefficient 2, but the norm of C dot in the iterative metric. So basically, the variation of the variation of the V R of C plus of C minus C plus minus V R of C minus, which is equal to 0, is equal to the integral of, is less than equal to the integral of 3 half, I guess, times C dot of T divided by the metric dt, and this is less than some constant type. I mean, the, I don't know about the coefficient, sorry. I shouldn't talk about the coefficient, because the coefficient actually depends on some, you have to integrate with the surface. So there is some coefficient type of length. I mean, time that I said the this one between C minus and C plus. Is this correct? And then what I should say is that this was extended by first by Kojima and Machai, who realized that you can apply the same idea for the touch point of distance, and also by Makolan, who actually noticed that you can use the same idea to get some similar bound, not in terms of bipartisan distance, but of any LP distance. So, I mean, the natural extensions using the same idea. So, I have 15 more minutes, I guess. So I'd just like to get to talk about a few applications of this. And so the first application is, I think, the most interesting application, but I'm not going to talk about it, because Jeff is going to talk about similar things, I don't know what, but on Friday. So there were those really nice ideas of Kojima, Machain, and Brock and Romberg using the estimate, the sort of new estimate on the volume of the convex core to obtain some estimate on the volume of mapping torus. Right? So the idea is that in this setting, should I say one word about this? So in this setting, you have this, mapping torus given by doing this surface to itself by some pseudo anosar isomorphism. So I'm going to call phi, and this m phi is mapping torus. So S plus 0 1 contributed by this identification of, I guess, x 1 is psi of x 0. And this is hyperbolic by the result of Thompson. And what I hope Jeff is going to explain is that you have a bound on the volume, the hyperbolic volume of this ensemble. And the bound comes from the bound on the volume of the convex core. Now, Jeff and Ken Bromberg have a very nice applications of this to the geometry of the bipartisan distance on modular spaces. And again, I'm not going to talk about this. I'd like to talk about some other applications, just to try to convince you that this can be interesting. So one application is to what is called Michaelis quasi-fixed reciprocity, or more generally, you know, convex or compact reciprocity. And the statement is the following. I mean, one way to state it, there are different ways to state this, but one way to state it is the following. So you have this, you know, manifold M, and you can look at all the quasi-reflection metrics on this. And for each metric, you have C and Q at infinity. And this defines, you know, a point in natural space and a cotangent vector, because those holomorphic quadratic differentials can be understood as cotangent vectors to natural space. So what you get is something, you know, which is a submanifold of the cotangent space. Oh, not of, oh, sorry, there is a huge dog in my slide. B is included in the cotangent of Teichmann space of the boundary, not of the Teichmann space of the boundary, of course.
Now,
and so I'm saying that this B is a Lagrangian submanifold. So it's, I mean, just recall, you know, just to show that this is not completely meaningless, it's the dimension of B is the dimension of the product of two copies of the Teichmann space of S by the Bell's double uniformization theorem. So this is 12G minus 12. And you know, we have this dimension of the Teichmann space, let's say, the Teichmann space of the boundary of the same dimension, and the cotangent of the Teichmann space of the boundary has twice this dimension. So it makes sense to ask whether this is the Lagrangian manifold of the whole quantity. And now we're claiming that this is a Lagrangian manifold. And the reason is extremely simple. You know, again, it's a direct consequence of this variation formula. So what is this? You know, remember the variation formula? It tells you that this the variation of the renormalized volume is minus the real part of the, you know, pairing between Q and C dot. So this tells you precisely that this renormalized volume restricted, I mean, defined, it's only defined on B, is equal, the variation of this renormalized volume is equal to the restriction to B of the Liouville function of the Liouville one form of this R. So just remember, maybe I should define this Liouville functional. This Liouville one form, sorry. So the Liouville one form is defined in the following way. So if you have the cotangent of this manifold M, so lambda of so you know, this is given by zero, some point in the entrance to the cotangent space. This is, I'm going to start it with the Tm plus T for M, and lambda of, let's say, B alpha is simply alpha B. So if you think of it, this is exactly what we're doing here, right? So Q is giving the cotangent vector to Teichmann space, and we do the pairing of this cotangent vector with a variation of the base point. So this is a Liouville functional. Now the point is that the key problem is here, so the Liouville one form is that d lambda is equal to omega. So here, if we restrict to B, we find that the restriction of omega B, the restriction of d lambda B, and it's the restriction of E of E dr to B, so it's equal to zero. Yeah? So directly. Now let me give some other applications, and I'm not going to define, you know, too much, to give too much proofs, but the idea is the following. So again, let's recall that Cp of S is the space of Cp1 factorial on S. So there is a nice map, which is called the grafting map, defined by Thurston, from the product of the Teichmann space of S across the measure dimensions on S to Cp1 factorial on S. Right? So there is a nice description of this map in case you're doing the measure dimension is a disjoint union of closed curves. So if you define by some surgery, you know, you realize those curves by closed geodesics, you cut along those geodesics, you open up, and you do some surgery, and you look at the corresponding Cp1 function. But a simple way to define this map, and that's enough for what we want to do, is that if you do, you know the situation we were talking about. So we have this you know, quasi-fractal manifold, we have the induced metric M and the measured lamination L. And then we can, look at the image by the graphing map of ML, and you are going to get exactly the CT1 functionality. Yeah? So you can look at this as a almost as a definition. And so Thurston proved that this map is a homeomorphism. That's really nice. You know, you can parameterize the space of CT1 structures on S by the product of the Teichmann space of S by the space of measured lamination. Yeah? And so now you could ask, you know, a number of things. And one thing you are interested, I tend to be interested in, is, you know, the complex, the symplectic structures, complex symplectic structures on CP. You know, that's a fairly rich space which has a number of interesting structures. And what we proved in the setting using the normalized volume is that this graphing map is symplectic. And if you say this in this way, it's completely meaningless, right? Because first, it's not even C1. And then, what is the symplectic structure on the Teichmann space across the space of measured laminations? And the point is that to understand the statement, you have to remember that you can identify the Teichmann space across the space of measured laminations with the cotangent of the Teichmann space of S. So let me correct this. So I'm telling that the product of the Teichmann space of S across the space of measured lamination is identified. So I'm claiming that T cross ML of S can be identified with the cotangent of S to the Teichmann space of S. And the way you do this is the simplest way you can think of. So you have L in the space of measured lamination S. So you look at the function length of L, you know, as a function of Teichmann space to R, and you take the differential at M of L of L, is it something in the cotangent space of M at M of T, right? So this is the identification that we're talking about. And now I'm telling that if you look at this grafting map, not from the Teichmann space across the space of measured laminations, but from the cotangent of the Teichmann space of S into CP. So this is, first, it's a C1. And this is a bit surprising, because actually there is no C1 structure from the space of measured laminations. So if you just think of the Teichmann space cross measured laminations, and you go into CP, you know, there is no way to say it's C1, because it's not even meaningful to say what it could be. It could be C1. But if you look at it as a space, as a map, from the cotangent of the Teichmann space of S into CP, this is actually C1. So now you see that Francis seems to be surprised by this, but in fact, the correct proof that we got for this came from him. So we talked about this many years ago, and we had an ugly proof, and he suggested a good proof. So, but maybe he forgot about it. Yes. I can show you your email. And it's not only C1, but it's actually symplectic up to some factor 2, something like this. Yeah. So on the, I hope I'm not going to say something wrong, but on the cotangent space, it's just cotangent bracket, and on the other space, I think it's a real part of the Goldman bracket, but I should check my paper because it could be the imaginary part. Okay, yeah. If I think of it, I'm going to recover it. I'm not going to tell you where this comes from, but basically it comes from looking at the renormalized volume of something which is not exactly the renormalized volume I talked about, but some relative version of it. And maybe there is another such similar application that is, I think, quite interesting. So again, the motivation is to understand the various symplectic structures on CP. And one way to understand CP, the space of complex projective structures, or maybe you want to understand something smaller, so you can look at the space of quasi-fractal manifolds, which is smaller than CP. And you can even look at something which is even smaller, and this is going to be the space of almost Fuchsian. And almost Fuchsian means that it's a quasi-fractal manifold that contains, let me redo one of the rules I erased. So it's one of those quasi-fractal manifolds that contains a minimal surface, they always contain such minimal surfaces, some surface, minimal surface here, but we want the minimal surface to have critical curvatures less than one, strictly less than one. And this is a really, you know, strong condition. So it's always true, you know, if you start from a Fuchsian manifold and you start deforming it, at the beginning it's always going to hold, and then at some point, you know, it will stop holding. But, you know, for good Fuchsian manifolds, this is true. And it has really nice consequences, and one nice consequence is that in this setting there is a unique manifold surface in this manifold. So this was true by Goldenberg in 1983. So now we have this unique minimum surface, and you can say, now I'm going to use this to parameterize the space of almost Fuchsian manifold. And how do I do this? I look at this minimum surface. So I have an induced metric, and I have something else, which is the second form of the surface, which is traceless because my surface is minimum. And also because it's a minimum surface in your hyperbolic manifold, it's not hard to prove that it's satisfied by the Kodaltsy equation. So the second form is the real part of some holomorphic quadratic differential, which we are going to call big cube. So we have, you know, some formal class of the induced metric, and we have this big cube. And this gives you a cotangent point in the Tachmann space of S. So we have a map from some domain in the space, in the cotangent space of Tachmann space of S, into your almost Fuchsian manifolds. And a very natural statement is that this is also this map, I can mean here, from almost Fuchsian manifold to the cotangent of the Tachmann space of S is symplectic of the Fuchsian factor. And again, you know, this is something that was proved by Brice Lousteau, using, you know, renormalized volume of something, which is, you know, basically half the renormalized volume of this quadratic Fuchsian manifold. Right. So I'm early, but I'll stop here. Thank you all for your attention.
Questions?
Oh, sorry, I forgot this. Yeah. I'm sorry for the typo, it's possible.
Excuse me, and if you just remove real part, so you take V dot equals QC, what do you get for that function?
Yeah, so there is a nice paper by Colin Guillermo and Sergio Moroyani. And they prove that this, I mean, basically the idea that everybody has, I guess, I mean, should have, is that the imaginary part should be the Chan Simon function of the manifold. And this is more or less what they prove. Except that they prove this, it's not really what they get, it's not really a function, it's a section of a bundle over the boundary, the Tachmann space of the boundary. So I don't have that result in mind at the moment. But basically they prove the natural thing, you know, that you get the imaginary part, which is the Chan Simons invariant of the manifold, but with some small twists. So, sorry that I cannot say more at the moment. We can look at it.
If you compose the two symplectic maps that you have at the end, then it goes from almost Fuchsian to CP1 structures, is that correct?
Yeah.
Is that a funny symplectic map? There's also a forgetful map that goes the same way.
I think it is interesting. I mean, there are different maps that you can look at. Basically, you know, you could do different things. You could also go from the minimum surface to the two components of infinity. And then this is also, these also has some technical properties in terms of the right difference of the form. And I think this quadratic synthetic form is connected to the Goldman's synthetic structure on CD1 by the result of Hawaii. So, I mean, all those things, yeah. So I think the point is this. What I should say is the point is this. The point is that people know, for some, you know, basic reasons, due to Hitchin, I guess, that CP has a hypercolor structure. Yeah? So that's something that people know, and it's also possible to understand it in a fairly basic way, in some manners, but. At least for me, it's not at all clear how to understand this in terms of hyperbolic geometry. So, you know, a hypokilometric means that you have three symplectic structures that commute in a nice way, right? And basically, you know, what you could do when you solve problems, as far as I know, doesn't really work. We need to say we have all those natural, you know, symplectic structures coming from, you know, minimal surfaces, drafting, whatever, and then we're going to understand those three commuting symplectic structures. And I think this is a goal. I don't think we can really understand it. So there are connections between all those things that I don't, you know, remember. I think if you want to look at this, you should look at the PhD thesis by Justo. So Justo looked at, he really thought about this in his PhD thesis, and he writes very clearly, and he obtained a number of nice results. This is only one of his results, but has other very nice results on this subject.
Can you say something about the image for this map minimal?
That's a good question. So, not much. So what I can tell you is that it's a neighborhood of the Fuchsian locus. Right. Now, I think what I should be able to tell you, what I can tell you is that it's not, I mean, there are results. I think it's pretty clear, but you know, it was pretty tough to prove rigorously, but results that by Wang, for instance, and Wang, that show that it's not the whole quasi-Fuchsian space. There are quasi-Fuchsian manifolds that admit several minimal surfaces. I mean, this is pretty clear, but you know, technically, I mean, it was a challenge to prove. So it's a neighborhood of the Fuchsian locus. It's not whole thing. So what else could we say? I think you know more than me about this. So I think what you can say. Yeah, I think you can probably say that. Yeah, you can probably give estimates that if the holomorphic quadratic differential is not too big, in a sense that I have to think about, then you get a normal fixture.